Good afternoon to members of the media who would have joined us here this afternoon for yet another MSJ press conference. As you know, we try every week to have these weekly press conferences in order to share our point of view with Trinidad and Tobago in terms of the many, many issues that we have, and indeed we have quite a lot. But let me just say two things before we get into the gist of what we want to speak about this morning. Is first of all, if it's one thing, is that the movement for social justice has always been consistent. Ever since our formation, all through these last 7 years or so, the MSJ has been consistent in terms of how we analyze how things are going, but also not just analyzing it, but also providing recommendations in terms of how we can improve Trinidad and Tobago. And the second point is that in all our statements, in all our analysis, in all our recommendations, it's all within the context of the system of governance. The MSJ has always been of the view, the very, very firm view, that our system of governance need a lot of changes. And we have oftentimes, as we look at the various issues, being symptomatic of that more fundamental issue of the poor system of governance, we have also tried to provide to Trinidad and Tobago a different construct as to how our system of governance can be improved. We also try to provide a different idea of leadership in terms of how we function within Trinidad and Tobago, try to build a better society. Our political leader, David Abdullah, has always maintained and has always been posing the question, what kind of Trinidad and Tobago, what kind of society do we want? And so every time we hold these press conferences, I think it's important that people understand the context in which we are having these press conferences. It's not simply to react or respond to issues, but really to share our analysis, share our proposals, share our recommendations, share our ideas as to how we can indeed change and shift the system of governance in Trinidad and Tobago. Now this morning, over the last week or two, there have been a lot of issues that have been in the public domain, a lot of debate, a lot of discussions. Well, this morning, our political leader, David Abdullah, will share his, the party's views, the party's analysis as to what has been happening over the last week or two, as well as how we as MSJ see us moving forward. So I now hand you over to our political leader, Comrade David Abdullah.
Our General Secretary, welcome to members of the media. Thanks for coming out on this Sunday afternoon to our media conference today. Over the last few days, there's of course been a raging debate and great concern in the press with respect specifically to the issue of the collapse of the sea bridge, in that the boat that had been contracted, namely the Ocean Flower 2, to be a fast ferry passenger vessel operating between Tobago and Trinidad, had the contract was terminated by the Port Authority and the Ministry of Works and Transportation. And that has resulted in a huge condemnation, quite correctly, of the government for its totally inept and perhaps worse than that handling of the situation. And subsequent to that, we have had the announcement by the Prime Minister of a one-man person to inquire into the circumstances of this whole imbroglio, Mr. Christian Muti. The MSJ issued a statement on that earlier, well, last week, and I will come back to that statement in a short while. But quite apart from that, it seems as if both the MSJ and myself are now, you know, being attacked by different political elements, interestingly, from both the PNM and the UNC spokesmen and supporters, as the case may be. On my radio program on Thursday last at 9:95, a number of persons called in and so on and tried to attack the position that we had articulated for a special prosecutor to be appointed. And one person, for example, said that you know, not successful as a politician, and I understand that a similar statement was made by a UNC member of parliament a short while ago on radio, saying that we may have good ideas, but we are not a successful political party or successful politician. But let me just make the point very, very clearly. It's interesting that these statements were coming from both the PNM and the UNC, which means that we are doing exactly the right thing because our ideas challenge the status quo, which status quo of an unequal, unfair, discriminatory economic, social, and political system. That status quo is propped up and maintained and nourished by both the PNM and the UNC when they are in government. So you're doing exactly the right thing to put forward ideas that challenge that status quo. Let me also say that some people believe that successful politicians are those who win elections by any means, including the exploitation of things like race and religion to win votes and to give out money to people to try to get people to vote for them on the basis that you're running something to people. That kind of politics, of course, has resulted in the system remaining exactly the same from independence to now, and certainly since our Republican status in 1976 to now. And because that system has remained the same, our society has become more unequal in terms of wealth and income than at any other point since slavery and indenture. And so both the PNM and the UNC, by maintaining the system, have maintained an unequal society. And the lives of people, the lives of ordinary people, and if we are honest, and even the supporters of the various parties, if they're honest, will say that regardless of which party has been in power, when they go to the hospital, they have been able to get a bed, or there are no medicines, or the doctors don't attend to them, or the doctors tell them, I can't do the surgery now, but if you come to my private hospital, we could do the surgery, and we'll charge you $70,000 or $100,000 or $200,000, as the case may be. And if we are honest with ourselves, regardless of which party you support, the problems of the primary schools, the poor pass rates for SEA, for CSEC, and all of these things have been continuing. School violence, all of these have been issues for people. The problems of housing and of land and so on, of roads, of water, all of those things, high and rising food prices, these issues that affect our citizens, particularly the working people and those who don't earn that much income, and our retirees, pensioners, and so on, as well as the unemployed. These issues have affected the majority of our citizens, regardless of which political party is in government. And so if success is defined as maintaining a system which makes the lives of people hard and difficult and tough and so on, we want no part of that kind of success. Success is measured by us in terms of new ideas that bring about real change. And we will succeed in bringing about real change in this country and therefore making the lives of everyone better. Not only the lives of those at the top, the so-called 1% better, but the lives of every single citizen of this country, make their lives better. And that is what the MSJ is about. That's what social justice means. Now, having said that, the issue of corruption is an issue that has been there regardless of which party has been in power. PNM, UNC, and so on, there's been corruption. And therefore, success for those parties has been success for themselves, their friends, their family, their political financiers, who have gotten fat through corruption off of taxpayers' money. And why is corruption important? It's important because when money is stolen, when there are kickbacks and bribes and contracts are inflated in order to benefit party financiers and others and so on, it means that taxpayers, in effect, get robbed of dollars, which dollars could be used to improve the hospitals, to improve schools, to build more homes for people, and to deal with the other problems like water and roads and so on, and basic infrastructure that every citizen deserves and which every community ought to have. That's why corruption is important. And what we have seen with this fast ferry issue and before that is a spectacular failure on the part of the political leadership to deal with the problem. And so all kinds of merry-go-rounds and smoke and mirrors are being created by setting up Mr. Moutet as a so-called investigator, when he has absolutely no power to investigate anything. He cannot, he has no legal authority to summon anybody as a witness, to get any document, to go into any office and take away a computer to access email information and so on and so forth to get at the root of the problem with respect to this ferry fiasco. The position of the MSJ is very, very simple. The traditional avenues that the system, this failed system of government has put forward as the way to deal with corruption, all of those avenues have failed. So when there have been allegations of corruption, remember the off inquiry into Unicot and other matters and so on, remember Las Alturas Commission of Inquiry, there was the CLICO HCL Commission of Inquiry, and so many other commissions of inquiry. Commissions of inquiry have failed spectacularly to result in anybody paying for the crimes that they may have committed, so that nobody does the time in Trinidad and Tobago. Nobody does the time. So you have a commission of inquiry, and they take weeks and months and sometimes years to be completed. Taxpayers pay for that, and the only people who benefit are the lawyers who have briefs to represent either the companies that have been inquired into, or individuals that have been inquired into, or the state and the attorney general, as the case may be. And so the lawyers make money, and the country gets back not a cent from possible acts of corruption. So commissions of inquiry don't work, and we know that. Secondly, the people say, this matter should be reported to the police. Well, unfortunately, the police have a track record of 0% of success with respect to investigating white-collar crime. In one of today's newspapers, we see a report that the police are looking for former Attorney General Alan Graham Logan to question him about witness tampering issues. Now, that issue arose in 2015, early 2015. Mr. Graham Logan was removed from the cabinet by then Prime Minister Kabir Prasad. In 2015, over this so-called or alleged witness tampering thing, which involved Mr. David West and so on, who is now head of the Police Complaints Authority. So from 2015, January or February, to August of 2017, 2.5 years, the police are now looking to try to question Mr. Graham Logan. Police are not able to deal and have not been able to deal with plant-like substance, with prison gate, email gate, and the whole range of issues that have been in the public domain over the years and so on. So that avenue does not work when it comes to white-collar crime. If you look, for example, at the Financial Intelligence Unit, which makes reports of suspicious transactions, and over the years, thousands of suspicious transactions have been identified, totaling billions, not hundreds of dollars, billions of dollars of suspicious transactions, which means not only corruption, but also money laundering, perhaps, and so on. Not a single person has been prosecuted as a result of the FIU reports. The FIU then provides the information to a unit within the police service. They have not been able to bring any prosecutions to closure on these matters, so that also does not work. When you look at the Integrity Commission, that is also a total waste of time in terms of investigating possible white-collar crime, and particularly matters with respect to persons in public life who are government officials, members of state boards, senior public servants, and so on. The Integrity Commission has not resulted in anyone paying for what they may have done if they did something wrong. And when the Deputy Commission does try to move the thing forward, that has resulted in court actions against the Deputy Commission, and many commissions, in fact, had to resign and fold up because it's been a waste of time. So, Commission of Inquiry, waste of time. Sending it to the police in terms of white-collar crime, waste of time. Integrity Commission, waste of time. And that is why, in terms of corruption, And we in the MSJ are saying that what has to happen is the establishment of a special prosecutor or special prosecutors who would have sole responsibility for managing the whole process of getting the evidence with respect to white collar crime and corruption. The special prosecutor will then be supported by a small team of highly trusted, well-trained police officers and so on. And the special prosecutor's office can be given a significant budget, the amount that is required to hire international forensic investigators or auditors who know how to follow the money and track it down between Trinidad and Tobago and wherever the money ends up in somebody's bank account via maybe 3-4 different countries and 5 or 10 banks, because that's how money launderers and corrupt people move their money around. But you have people who are experienced and trained to do that work. Now, there have been a number of criticisms, because when we sent out the media release, somebody put up on Facebook in response to our release that we don't know the constitution or the law, that only applies to the United States. Well, that was a foolish statement by that person in response to our statement, because in Trinidad and Tobago, we have had special prosecutors. There's been more than one instance in Trinidad and Tobago of special prosecutors. So for those who have convenient memory lapses, or those who are too young to know, and so on, or those who deliberately do not wish to accept the reality, then under the NAR, one Desmond Allen, now unfortunately who passed away in 2010, one of our country's best criminal lawyers, was appointed a special prosecutor with respect to information and some evidence that had come out of the Scott drug inquiry. And as a result of that, Desmond Allen actually had charges brought against former Commissioner of Police Randolph Burroughs, and Burroughs was brought before the court. So that special prosecutor operated at that time. And then under the UNC government of 95 to 2000, when Mr. Ramesh Maharaj was Attorney General, special prosecutor was also appointed in the person of another very well-known, excellent criminal lawyer, Carl Hudson Phillips. And that special prosecutor's office, together with the support of forensic auditors and police officers, resulted, with respect to the Piako Airport construction, in people in the United States going to jail because evidence was uncovered, which led to persons being charged in the United States, going to jail, and money being returned to Trinidad and Tobago from acts of corruption arising out of the Piako Airport construction. And persons in Trinidad and Tobago, charges brought against them. Unfortunately, our criminal justice system in this country, the wheels move so slowly that those matters are still before the magistrate's court. They have not gone to full trial at the level of the Supreme Court. Suffice it to say also that we must never forget that the UNC passed, the cabinet passed, or agreed to have the President of the Republic promulgate Section 34 of the piece of legislation which would have enabled, that Section 34, all persons who had matters more than 10 years old and which matters were not blood crimes like murder and so on, they would have been able to get off scot-free, Section 34. So, we are saying that what ought to be done now, and this ought to have been done in September of 2015, and in fact, the Rowley government, the Prime Minister himself, was personally and individually advised on more than one occasion, and I can speak to this as fact because I was present and was part of those discussions where he was so advised, to have this process of a special prosecutor appointed. And had we had a special prosecutor appointed in 2015, then many of the issues of allegations of corruption that were allegations of corruption during the UNC period would have been investigated, and by now persons would either have been brought before the court on criminal charges or their names would have been exonerated. One way or the other, we could have begun to bring closure to those matters. And with respect to the sea bridge issue, the best route to go is by way of a special prosecutor, not a commission of inquiry, not a one-man investigator who can't investigate anything, but by way of a special prosecutor. And the question must be asked as to why neither the UNC nor the PNM is interested in going the route of a special prosecutor. And the only logical answer that we could come up with, unless proven otherwise, is that both the UNC and the PNM have cocoa in the sun and don't want special prosecutors to investigate matters which may end up having their own members and officials and so on being brought before the courts. And so we are arguing that this is something that must be done, and it is something that we will continue to take to the public and put pressure on the government until special prosecutors are appointed to investigate all acts of corruption, whether it be with respect to the procurement of the sea bridge or otherwise. And lastly, both the government and the opposition have spectacularly failed to bring legislation to deal with party finances to the parliament, to regulate party finances. And until we have strong party finance legislation coupled with strong procurement legislation, coupled with the office of a special prosecutor, coupled with more teeth for the financial intelligence unit, then we are not going to get a hand on corruption, and taxpayers' money will continue to go into the hands and pockets of a few rather than benefiting everyone in terms of better roads, water, improved healthcare, better quality school facilities, and better education and other community requirements. Thank you.
Thank you very much. From the media. All right, I think it was clear. So with that.
Express, right?
No. Whatever you do.
No, that's it?
Okay.
All right, I think, thank you very much, David.
One thing that we're calling for, special prosecutor,
yeah,
who will be supported by the highly trained, trusted team of police officers and forensic auditor, but it's a special prosecutor who will have responsibility. Okay?
Thank you very much, members of the media, for attending our press conference.